Decolonize. Oh, Canada. Oh, United States.
Stratford, Vermont, and in Stratford I was Santa Claus for 10 years, and I really care about kids. Would love to see the world left that they could play in and enjoy as I have. The oil, the gas, and the coal that's in the ground, it has to stay in the ground. Have to control climate change. Not tomorrow, it's not in the future, it's now. So I ask everybody to do your part, work at it for our kids. For the future, for the little guys who are coming along. I care about them. I hope you will too.
Pipeline to be stopped, and we want the MOU that the governor and the Public Service Department has signed with the gas company to be canceled, and we want the certificate of public good that the Public Service Board has given the gas company to be revoked.
On action agreements and intended to set the tone of the action and keep all participants safe. So there are six of them, and I'll just read them out. I will be dignified and respectful in my behavior. These are serious issues, and we are worthy of respect. Two, I promise to be nonviolent and peaceful in all of my activities during the action. I will not engage in destruction or defacement of property or in actions that could physically harm another person. Three, I assume all risks that may stem from taking part in this action. I will take accountability for my actions. Four, I will respect the hard work of the organizers by helping to make the plan successful. Five, I will stay on message while engaging with the media and passerby. Six, I will not criticize, attack, or undermine anyone's actions to the police, the media, or the public at large, but will make any concerns I have known to the organizers involved in order to improve our work together. Does everybody feel good about those agreements?
Yes!
We are unstoppable. Another world is possible.
Down there, protesting for a future or whatever it is you want. But I'm here to tell you, me, Chris Recchia, the head of the Department of Public Service, that there's a lot of money in this deal, and you can't stand in the way of progress, and if you don't have the brains to try to be the last person standing on this planet, well, me and my rich cronies do.
To see everybody out here and to know that this struggle has been going on for a few years. How many folks were here last year on October 27th when we occupied the governor's office? I had the honor to be part of a nonviolent civil disobedience on the fall equinox on September 21st with this wonderful group of people, the Williston Six, the Upper Valley Affinity Group, who's up here with me. And it was just an honor to be awake at dawn with these amazing elders as the sun's coming up in over the Winooski, the fog, and helping these elders get locked to the gates of the Williston Pipe Yard.
Our next speaker is Charlie Magazo, a Nohegan Coosex citizen who has been involved in the Indigenous Peoples Movement for over 25 years. And
decolonize. Oh, Canada. Oh, United States. This is what we must look at. You say you have clean energy, but who does it affect? The original peoples first. The Lubicon, the Cree. They have a higher incidence of cancer. And pristine waters in a lake that they've created that's all pollution. There's a ring and several rings around that in terms of where the cancers are. And as they do this to everything, those rings get bigger, they get closer. We all have been given the idea that we have clean energy because in Vermont, we don't see that effect here, right? We don't see it in the greater United States. They want you to believe that it is okay. The air that we breathe here right now, the land that we stand on, the Dakana, our homeland right now, Vermont, this is the same land, same air that's in Alberta, that's in the Amazon, that is in other places that are being compromised in the environment. We want to be able to survive. We want to be able to live. This is what we desire for ourselves, for our children, for our children's children. This legislature has passed no fracking in Vermont, but we have a public service board who doesn't seem to understand what that means. It's okay to bring this forward. It's okay to bring this gas in. What's affected so many other people in the environment, as long as it's not our people and our environment. This is what they have been selling this forever. And as that ring gets tighter, this pollution will come our way. But this is something that we can look at and say no to. We can choose. We can choose to change our path, our way of thinking. These people work for us. I ask the Canadian government, I ask the U.S. government to stop giving proxy tribal governments. You're the chief. We'll give you a ton of money. Then you sell us the land and we got the resources. Well, here, they're colonizing you. They're doing it to you now. Do you have a say with the Public Service Board? Do you have a say in the future in terms of what clean energy is? Nope. Is the average citizen able to do that?
Nope.
This is what we're talking about. Decolonize. Decolonize. Give people back the authority. We give the authority to the government. It's not the other way around. They need to be reminded of this. This is the Abenaki way. Decolonize.
So Jane Palmer lives in Moncton on land that is currently threatened by the pipeline project. And so she's an intervener in the permitting process and was previously arrested at knitting in at Vermont Gas office when they didn't refuse to listen to her. She's also a fan of Tom Petty and has vowed never to back down. Mary Martin, to her left, used to think that climate change was a lie that Al Gore manufactured. Now, ever since then, she's been fighting fiercely to stop the project and unite her community around pipeline resistance. So both of these ladies are not afraid to face off with Vermont Gas, whether it's in a hearing or on a construction site of the pipeline. Give it up for Jane and Mary.
Hi. I don't feel like a hero. You guys are the heroes. Really. I live in Moncton. About 3 years ago, my husband and I had a call from Vermont Gas, and they said they wanted to put a pipeline through the heart of our farm. We resisted. We are still resisting. We have learned more than we ever wanted to know about methane and regulatory system in this state, and how it is extracted and how it is transported. And we learned firsthand how the utility regulatory system in this state is corrupted and broken. 14 years ago, my husband and I stopped burning fossil fuel to heat our home because we knew that human abuse of fossil fuels is hurting the planet. But now, this huge, expensive, invasive pipeline was being planned to cut through the state of Vermont and our lives as well. But how do you resist something that seems inevitable? How do you resist something that the gas company falsely claims will save Vermonters money? How do you convince policymakers that just because the gas company says burning fracked gas is better for the environment, that doesn't make it true? How do you deconstruct the lies and untruths that the gas company and our government is spending millions of dollars to spread when those lies are what some people want to hear? Back when this project was just beginning, Rising Tide was onto our government and the way the Department of Public Service and our governor had already made up their minds that this project would be built. They even took a giant rubber stamp to the DPS office and handed it to them, symbolizing the lack of oversight and transparency our regulatory system was demonstrating. At that time, I was still hoping that if enough people stood up and spoke out against the project, that the Public Service Board would have to condemn it. At that time, I still had faith in the regulatory system. In March of 2013, I went to the Public Service Board's public hearing on the fracked gas pipeline, and there was an overwhelming majority of people who spoke out eloquently about the project, against the project. And every public hearing after that was dominated by those who are against the project. I still had hopes that if enough of us got together and had denounced the project, the Department of Public Service and the PSB would have no choice but to listen to us. Well, silly me. So here we are, almost 3 years later, and the PSB is still deliberating about whether or not VGS will retain their right to build this insane pipeline, but only because of the inadequacies and blundering of Vermont Gas, not because of the opposition. So Rising Tide was spot on from the get-go. After playing by their rules and getting nowhere, I am not here to ask the PSB to do what they should have done 3 years ago. I have said it before. If the people's voices are ignored, they will only get louder. I am here to demand they shut it down.
Over 3 years ago, Vermont Gas said they needed $86 million to complete their pipeline before the end of 2014. Then in July of 2014, they said they needed $121 million. Zip forward, December 2014. Still not built, but they needed $154 million. At the last hearing, the number was $162.4 million, double the original price. So here we are, October 2015, a 43-mile long pipeline has even left Chittenden County. Yet Vermont Gas repeatedly says, we are on time and on budget. Yes. Well, which time and what budget? What's changed for Vermont Gas? Well, let's see. The cost, the destination, remember IP in Rutland? The accountants, the land agents, the surveyors, the construction company, the PR person, the CEO, they've all been fired or replaced. Incompetence or arrogance? They continue to say, on time and on budget. The savings they promised are gone. The clean energy choice does not exist with fracked gas. Gas has proven to be as dirty as coal. That's what's changed for Vermont Gas. What's changed for us? Our numbers have grown, and our stand today is stronger than it was back then. No pipeline. Our arguments have been bolstered by newer technologies like heat pumps. Middlebury businesses have their fracked gas without a pipeline. What's changed? Everything but us. We are here again to stand together. Raise your fists, because we're here to rise up and shut this down.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce to you Commissioner Chris the Wrecker Recchia on top of the fracking rig. It appears he has the Vermont economy in his grips.
He is going to force the Vermont economy off the top of the frack rig into this teacup. Through this fracked gas pipeline. Yeah. Okay, everybody stand back.
This December. Woo! From labor to climate organizing, I trust Sonoda to always be standing up for her community and speaking truth to power. Here you go.
What I wanted to say today is what's happening in Vermont is directly related to the counter protests and delegations in Paris. We need a just transition. We need to have a say in where our energy is coming from, and right now, that's not happening. That's not happening on a global scale. That's not happening on a local scale. And we need to change that.
Call your friends, get your camping equipment, and we'll just stay here until they answer our demands. And cancel the pipeline and stop making these backroom deals, right? Yeah! We have former president of the VSCA from Berry City, Ed Stanek, working 30 years administering Act 250, going to talk to us about solidarity. Give it up for Ed Stanek. Now, I moved
to a lot of these rallies over the years, I never thought I'd stand here and quote a pope. But the pope, in his recent encyclical on the planet and the state of the environment, talked a lot about intergenerational solidarity. And I look out here, and this is intergenerational solidarity. We are here in solidarity with the pregnant women who live near the fracking wells. We are here in solidarity with the people in New York State that can no longer drink their water from their wells. We on the east side of the Green Mountains are in solidarity with the brothers and sisters from the west side. There will be no pipeline in Addison County. And we come together in solidarity because of the corruption of government process in Vermont. And this is up here in what's called the Public Service Board. It should be called the Public Disservice Board. The Public Disservice Board, by law, is supposed to administer, as a quasi-judicial board, justice. And last but not least, we have our governor on the top floor of the building over there. This is the same governor who suddenly had this epiphany, and he's talking about how large industrial-scale energy projects are problems for the grid and are economically warped. This is the system which has been dumping on brothers and sisters from the Northeast Kingdom for years now as they raise these same issues and before the Public Disservice Board. We have to stand together on all these issues. This is a corruption of the fundamental process. The change we need, folks, the change we need, history shows us, will not originate in that building over there. The changes we need in this country, history shows us, originates here by people taking collective action. This collective energy, this collective action by you, me, and other brothers and sisters builds energy which cannot be extinguished, and that results in the change that we want. So we're here in solidarity with the people from Island Pond to Middlebury, from Newport to Brattleboro. We stand together. Solidarity now, solidarity tomorrow, solidarity forever.
Just a second, Straw. Just a second. There appears to be a puppet show happening from the Frack Tower. Ladies and gentlemen, turn your eyes to once again witness.
Say hello to all the buddies. These people out here are supporting you guys to be able to do whatever you want, aren't they? Aren't you guys?
No!
Oh, oh no!
Wow, it's so realistic.
Who loves an energy economy totally dependent on scarce resources? Unanimity. You guys like consensus down there, right?
What should we do?
No.
Cut the ties.
Listen, I'm not messing around. This is neoliberal competition at its finest. I'm not joking. This isn't funny. Competition so that the strongest rise to the top. Like me, capitalism. Why would I be here unless
Come
I was.
Capitalism doesn't
tie.
Work.
He's still wearing a tie.
We will always be tied to capitalism because the people will be held down by the military and industrial complex.
So the bus sign I've seen yet here today is compost capitalism. We can take that down and compost it. We are already seeing several climatic changes here in Vermont, and we expect to see more. Let's just talk about what it means to be a farmer when you have to face these. Climate change is expected to increase overall temperature. What does that mean for agriculture? It means your livestock are going to be stressed, milk production's going to go down, egg production's going to go down, more food insecurity. It means there's going to be more diseases and pests that happen in this state. We already have enough diseases and pests, we don't need more. When you have warmer climates, fungi and bacteria, they love to reproduce in those environments. That means more fungicides most likely being sprayed in the Northeast. Insects will be able to have more life cycles. And insects that didn't used to be able to live here are already coming here. We see these new insects every day. Also, warmer temperatures bring in more prolific noxious weeds, herbicides. Not that I've ever used any of those things, but that's what's predicted is going to happen because there's going to be so many new insects, pests, diseases coming our way. Climate change is also expected to increase overall precipitation, but less rain here in the summer when farmers need it. So what does that mean? We're going to probably see more droughts here in Vermont, even that you think we're a water-rich state. So having more drought days means we are going to have to irrigate more and use our precious resource of water that we have. Climate change is also expected to have fewer snow cover days. You might think that's fine, but what does that actually mean? It means a lot of things for winter wheat, grapes, apples. Crops that rely on having a winter chilling or vernalization, it means they might not be able to have the pollinators here at the same time, so crop yield is going to go down. All of this obviously leading into food insecurity in our state. But the climate change effect that has been most visible and violent in the state of Vermont is the occurrence of more heavy, dramatic precipitation events. So we're not talking about, which leads to flooding. We're not talking about flooding in spring when you see the snow melt off the mountains. We expect that. We're in a state that floods. But we're talking about flooding in the month of May, in the month of August, in the month of September. And we've seen this. You all know about Tropical Storm Irene. 476 farms affected by Tropical Storm Irene. Damage to 7,200 acres of hay, 6,000 acres of corn, 1,700 acres of pasture, 225 acres of soybeans, and nearly 600 acres of vegetables and fruits. All of that we could not eat. The livestock could not eat. All of that was completely wasted, had to be put back in the ground. Food insecurity. These are the effects of climate change in agriculture, just a few of what we've already seen here today, and we only expect more, not only in Vermont, but around the country, around the world. Climate change basically equals food insecurity. So why the hell is Governor Shumlin making backroom deals with Vermont Gas for a pipeline that relies on frack gas? Why is Shumlin's administration not making the connection that when you invest in gas pipelines that destroy our farmland and frack gas, you invest in making climate change worse? You are investing essentially in more Tropical Storm Irenes, and that's not what this state needs to be investing in. So Shumlin, stop these backroom deals with Vermont Gas, stop the pipeline, and instead fight for the green Vermont you always talk about in the media, and finally commit to Vermont to relying on renewable energies. Thank you.
Yeah. We say rise up, you say shut it down! Rise up!
Shut it down!
And the chant goes, quit your job and join us.
Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us. Quit your job and join us! Quit your job and join us! Quit your job and join us!
Okay, everybody!
Quit your job and join us!
I've been watching you guys for a little while, and I have to admit that I'm touched. You know, I've been part of this system of what I realize now is quasi-democracy for my whole career. But maybe some crooks liquidating all of our futures so that they can try and create a green zone that they can survive in while the rest of us drown or become food insecure and land insecure and turn into refugees with the huge population of people who are already in that situation. Maybe that's not what we want.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
I think that I have to agree. I think I've got to agree with what you guys are saying.
Yeah.
If it's capitalism versus the climate and our futures, then it's us versus capitalism.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Not just Exxon and Shell Oil, but every piece of capitalism, including all of the corporate lobbying that runs everything that goes on under that hunk of gold over there. We're gonna have to take over, and I wanna be part of that.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Can I come hang out with you guys?
Come hang out with us. We have food. We're going to sketch out a mural on the right in the middle of the road with chalk and paint it up with tempera paint. We're going to hang out. We're going to camp out the night. Go call your friends. Get people to bring tents, sleeping bags. Seriously, it's not too late to call. There's going to be trips to the library for kids who want to go to the library or up to the Enchanted Forest. And we're going to stay here, and we're going to come back. If you leave, come back on Monday morning, and we're going to go up into the office of the Department of Public Service and bring these demands to the people who are making these backroom deals. Who's going to come back Monday?
They've got pictures of us.
Yes. I guess amongst themselves about putting out the fire, and they've asked for help with the fire.
You want to do that? That's okay. We'll give you a minute. I really appreciate that.
I'm doing it. Great.
So, they have stated they are going to put the fire out. I would move for cooperation, but
yeah.
This is consensus.
And maybe we can put it out ourselves. You want us to put it out?
Yeah.
You got water?
Yeah.
Any water?
I got some water.
Okay. Let's not put it out right there.
Yeah.
Let's drag
we'll move it
to the gutter and put it out.
Right.
I don't know.
No, they want it out.
They want it out now.
If that's okay with everybody, is there any problem with us putting it out?
I don't know. They've been accommodating us.
Yeah. I mean, we kind of.
Not even cold.
It kind of would be it would be too bad to make a. Yeah.
They've been super.
Like
they've been pretty cool.
I bet we can probably hook it.
If everyone just takes a middle section and lift, it's very light.
Right.
You know how dangerous these things are.
You don't need it. You don't need it.
Set it down in that curb, and I'll pour water in there, and put it
down. And yet again, the flames of democracy are extinguished by the cold, cold waters of oppression.
No, that's all right.
I think we got consensus with them. It was like pretty good consensus with the state. The rules only almost that simple.
Kind of been the day when your tribe needed to be warm on the streets, but I guess that's good. This ain't no America any longer.
can go water up here.
Oh, you got water?
Just help me out a little bit.
Yeah.
Hopefully the sun will come out. It's getting a little warmer.
You almost have to come halfway
around. How's that looking level-wise?
We're just here and in touch with the fire chief.
Well, I'm
about getting emergency
seconds,
vehicles.
Seconds matter,
right?
And they're not going to get down the street fast. So I ask that you consider that, please.
Yeah, okay. We'll take that into consideration. Thanks.
Okay.
Thanks for your concern.
Fortress down.
We are the shifting of the ground. We are the seas that take root as we tear the fortress down.
So, something that was put together specifically about what's happening in the campaign right now, the Eminent Domain papers being filed on 9 homes in Addison County, and the MOU, the DPS cut with Vermont Gas. So, yes, the Memorandum of Understanding, which is bureaucratic ease for secret backroom deal.
All right, everybody, let's roll. Front team, let's go ahead and get in position. The back team is the most important.
Vermont Gas has tried to take homeowners' land through eminent domain. Just last week, they issued eminent domain letters for 10 homeowners who are holding out against the pipeline. Completely unacceptable for a for-profit corporation to take citizens' land just because they want to. What's next? Google wants the gold out of my teeth. The Public Service Board is the doer, is the hand-in-glove facilitator of these big projects that benefit like for-profit corporations. In this case, Gas Metro, Vermont Gas, a Russian multinational. It's completely unacceptable that our government just like does whatever these corporations want and then puts the cost on the citizens of Vermont. Natural gas is a false solution to climate change. It is not a bridge fuel. Methane is 120 times more heat trapping as a greenhouse gas. The damage to the water supply, that's really what makes me crazy. It's like if we're blowing up America's water for the whole future of our country for 5 minutes worth of propane, I think it's just completely unacceptable. As a patriot, as an American. Language of democracy, like I think Republicans have beat up the language of like patriotism, but this is a patriotic movement to like stand up for our country and its rights, and democracy is being undermined by corporate power that's just so in its head about what it wants to do.
Seven.
Yeah.
It was 10 the other day.
Yeah, he has no idea. And we called everybody we know that has a sign, and only two had gotten of course, they're talking to their lawyers, so.
So they just make up numbers and then figure out if it works. And
yeah.
It seems to be like the whole industry does that. It's like
exactly.
Pretend numbers, pretend, yeah. Pretend filling in your paperwork.
Just speak with authority and people will listen and think you're telling them.
It's fine if no one cares. Like, I think like the idea was that like if you're out in Pennsylvania, you just have to basically put the paperwork in and no one looks. It's not like the Department of Public Safety is trying to catch it.
Well, that's the thing. It's like, you know, they're trying to give you a free car, you know? Say, here's this free car, and it gets half the gas mileage. Are you going to read the fine print and find out what the details are? You know, nobody is. They're just saying, yeah, I want this free car.
Yeah.
It's like,
all right.
Yeah. It's like nobody's paying attention. Not nobody. We are. We're paying attention.
We are.
Suffering, it's a little bit painful to try and wake up to the nature of it.
Yeah, I always think about the dog trying to wake the owner up when the building is burning, you know, and you just want to say, shut up, just stop barking, let me go back to sleep, but the dog is persistent. You know, we're the dogs.
That's
you know,
right.
The house is on fire.
This week we learned that Exxon knew in the 80s that climate change was real. The moral crime of that to like unfold the entire like climate change era upon the human race. It's very dark.
Come too far, we won't turn around. We'll
stop this fracking nightmare. No more pipes in the ground. We have come too far. We won't turn around. We'll stop this fracking nightmare. No more pipes in the ground. We have come too far. We won't turn around. We'll stop this fracking nightmare. No more pipes in the ground.
It doesn't take much to, then I'll be comfortable.
Realize what we're up against. You know, humanity has to reclaim the reins of this thing. It's like the Martian attack, you know, where humanity has to get together against the machine. In this case, the Martian is the logic of unaccountable corporate power that just wants to do things without any sense of ecology or physics or what people need. It's all one, and we have to be like together. We have to be ethical. We have to be long-term thinking, plan for future generations. So, Pope's encyclical deals with a lot of that very eloquently, arguing the world's poor are already feeling the thumb of climate, and so it's immoral just to keep rolling it out. And if we want to be an authentic humanity, we have to respond to protecting our earth, protecting our future, protecting future generations. It's not enough just to be like, you know, like live on the earth like demented renters who are like ripping the pipes out to just be like, 5 minutes, we're the gas, let's smash the windows. It's like, who lives that way? Junkies. We're not junkies, we're humans. We're gonna like live here. And we deserve to be able to protect our water and future. And that's what we're up about. And it's not, we're not going anywhere. This we're here to stay, this mind, this ecological, determined ecological mind that wants to save the planet. That's what it's about.
Let me out of here.
Any martyrs? Better a Christian than a martyr.
to find some other way to call them for a hearing. You know what? So the White House is going to do that. We're going
to
sue back.
Here, and again, we have to be flexible in how we have a response to that. And due to the low traffic impact, we did allow the road to be closed temporarily over the weekend. But one of the concerns that we did have, that we would have to make sure the road was open for Monday morning commute because of the impact there. So we had communication with the group throughout the weekend, and as a result of it, some discussions last night, the group committed that we would have two-way traffic. We had a coordinated plan, which we implemented, and they were true to their word in that they would be breaking things down and out of here by 11 o'clock. So that part, was just good communication, cooperation, because again, nobody wanted it, to see, the group didn't want to adversely impact, people from Montpelier itself commuting through here. And we certainly had to make sure that the road was going to be open this morning, which it was.
Kind of unusual.
The agreement wasn't 4:30 a.m.? I thought it was 4:30 a.m.
It was 4 o'clock in the a.m. The road was open. That's when it was open on schedule at 4 o'clock in the morning.
Kind of unusual to have this kind of coordination with a protest group?
I wouldn't call it unusual. Every protest is different. Not always are we going to be able to find some common ground and what's reasonable or not. So again, we try to balance the needs of everybody, but public safety, first and foremost, is always our concern in Montpelier.
What do you say to folks who said the Montpelier cops were soft over the weekend, that the public has a right to drive through town?
Well, they do have a right. We felt it was a reasonable action to take on our part, to also have some sort of idea of what to expect, and not just have an impromptu protest, ignite again somewhere else where we don't have resources in place. So again, we think there was minimal impact over the weekend. Certainly, that's why we did take the action no matter what. We made clear that the road would have to be open, the two-way traffic, as well as the sidewalks for today, which it in fact was. And also I want to add that separate from that, the Montpelier Police Department did have to make 3 arrests here at 112 State Street for disorderly conduct.
Could you kind of describe how that played out?
Sure. The first arrest was an individual who chained himself to the rear door. Our officers used bolt cutters, freed the subject from the rear of the building, took him, transported him to the Montpelier Police Department, and then 2 other individuals were arrested in the front of the building here for denying access to the stairwell. And all 3 have been cited and released, and will be appearing in Washington Superior Court on December 12th for disorderly conduct.
There's no damage to the building?
No damage at all. So again, measured response, I would say, and what's reasonable. So we did make arrests where we had to make arrests, and the rest, we had the best coordination and communication that we could, given the circumstances.
I was just trying to think of a hypothetical over the weekend. I mean, if there had been people camped all over the...
Every situation is going to be different. The law is still there. And so, again, we are just... Balance is the really key word here with civil disobedience, public, freedom of speech, as well as what are the needs of the public good for transportation so we can act and access.
Do you think that the decision that you settled on actually helped... helped ensure that there were fewer problems? Because as you said, that you worried about an impromptu setup someplace else.
Correct.
You think that balance really worked?
I would like to hope so. And certainly what we did see, they did follow through with their commitment to me from last night. And I was here yesterday evening when we started to set up the plan, and they had already moved their symbolic oil drilling platform. Everything was coordinated as far as that part goes.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. You. See how it feels on the gate now. Does that look at you, Kenji?
Okay, this is hooked in here now. They were sleeping right in the middle of the road. Camping out in the middle of the road. Is that crazy or what? You want to know why? Because they were trying to say that one of these things is happening in August 2009 is not working for us and it's not a good one. So we're going to camp out right in the middle of the road and stop them from going down. Isn't that pretty neat?
Yeah, it feels so.
We just talked about the protests, what they were trying to get involved. Got a couple interviews, got some video, they said they have a game.